Take a seat again. I appreciate if we can have the table with mix of people from different transit agencies and university and different entities. That would be awesome. I would appreciate if we can take these four tables in the front, just to make sure we are all over. That would be great. Thank you so much. So with no further delay, I would like to move on to the next presentation, and I would ask Michelle to join us for the next presentation. Come on with your big round of applause.
his name.
Michelle, could you repeat the question? I couldn't hear the question.
Yeah, he said it's one type of trade-off is between the political consideration and putting certain things for political reasons, even if that's not.
going to mention that, then there are cases like in Seattle where they worked with the DOT to build special bus ramps.
Yes.
To avoid some of those circuitous paths.
Absolutely, yes. There are places in the world where there's an option on the freeway and all the time to get off the train. And I think that can happen very easily.
I understand that. I understand the trouble with it, but it needs to make sense that the highway and waiver is in the way. But the route that I take it down now is on one main road, that if you just stay on that road, it would go straight to downtown. Instead, for some reason, that for me, selfishly, I don't like, it goes off that road and meanders through neighborhoods and comes back and then gets back on the road to downtown. And it kills me every time because you just stayed on that road. For the reasons, I understand, and you're selfish as a rider.
And I think we didn't talk about that first, necessarily, the internal magnetic thing, and the story of stuff.
Yeah.
I feel like you can use that for the internal magnetic thing, and when you know you want to go that way, and you are going to go this way,
right.
Well, that's, you know, that's, it may be about walking, right, how hard we have to walk.
how are you going to justify not doing that in a place that we know would absolutely use it? If you gave 10-minute service to lower income areas, they would absolutely use it, and they need to follow resources.
Mm-hmm.
And we agreed in that meeting that we were not going to have that debate in public. I just said, I want you to know that when you decided to, you know, pilot was successful of getting lots of people to ride basically Uber on our dollars, that I'm going to make sure that someone's going to, you know, raise their hand and say, why can't you do that everywhere? It's because you can't afford to provide that kind of service area, but the staff has made all these decisions without bringing it to the board and saying exactly why they were doing what they were doing. So, you know, we're approving all these pilots, and it looks good, it sounds good. You know, we're getting a grant from someone to do this thing, but I know, you know, at some point they're going to say, all right, the pilot was successful, let's provide this to the rest of the low-density, high-income areas just like this. So I'm concerned about it. That hasn't made its way out yet, but
yeah.
I see that as an example of a specialization deal.
Yeah, just as a former board member of Trinity Metro, former Florida Transportation Authority, I would just encourage downtown, our downtown board, we had Molly the Trolley, we have it now, and we were, the board was funding it, and it was costing. So we went to the stakeholders. So I think the opportunity is going to the stakeholders who really wanted it, you know, destination. Everybody wants to be downtown, Sundance Square, Omni Hotel. So we encouraged, you know, the stakeholders, the business community, to put skin in the game. And I think that's where the opportunity is on the specialized routes, the choice riders, those that are going to the football game, TCUs and all of that. So, you know, we made it a point to go to the business community. If you want it, you've got to pay some, put a portion in on it, increase your pay. Because the authority, public entity, 0.5% sales tax, it wasn't adding up. So I think those are where the opportunities to go to the business community that are like, hey, we want this specialized service, we want to make sure it looks good downtown. I think those are the opportunities to do those kinds of things. Yeah.
Well, let me just say that since Andre left the board, he left us with a good legacy. And last week we inaugurated electric buses running a route from downtown through the entertainment district out to the museum district to the new Dickies Arena and returning every 15 minutes. And in the entertainment district, we have a regular bus line, so really they run every 7 minutes in that area, which I think is a good frequency rate. And to do that, we formed a public-private partnership with the entertainment district tenants. And so they're funding part of that electric bus line. And so that seems to be the new pattern we have in Fort Worth, is that we're forming more of these public-private partnerships where we run the train up to the Mercantile Center, and VIA runs in a 5-mile radius out of that center to employment with 14,000 employees around that center. And so their employers are subsidizing their rate for riding VIA.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was actually doing a study on this type of service, and I won't mention agencies, but there was one agency that told us that they purposely didn't advertise the service,
right,
because they didn't want more people to ride it, since every rider costs money.
Right.
So a lot of people just didn't know that the service existed. They didn't put signs up. They didn't. Nobody knew about the app. I was just going to ask a clarifying question. By microtransit, are you talking about shared ride services? Okay. Okay.
And Uber and Lyft offers that only in certain markets.
Yeah.
And again, that's one thing in Texas.
It's happening in Arlington.
Okay, so yeah,